We are in this prayer series. I'm loving every week. It's where God has us, and it's what He has for our hearts and lives. And I'm hearing from people that are new in the faith. It's giving them a track to run on, to growing in their understanding of prayer and what it means to fellowship, commune. We're in union with our Father, but to be in communion with Him. And then I hear from people that have been in the faith for a long time and still learning and growing. People I love and respect, and the things they say blows my mind to see how God speaks to all of our hearts right where we are at. And so we've been talking about when you pray. When you pray, the direction of our prayer. Pray then, Matthew 6:9. Pray then like this. Now, this is Jesus. He's not saying pray this prayer. It's not that we pray it over and over and over and over. That's not the objective. But He said, when you pray, pray like this. And then He gives us an outline of what to pray. Pray like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Our Father, I thank You I can call You Father today. I thank You I call You Father by virtue of the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, no cure, no answer for sin. But I have been made righteous by the blood of Jesus. And so we understand, we call Him Father by virtue of the blood, that the blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness, cleanses us spirit, soul, and body. The blood of Jesus backs the promises of God. When we take communion, the Lord's table, we read the passage of Scripture. Jesus declared this. This blood, this is the new covenant in My blood. He backs His promises by His blood. He gives access to the very presence of God. We're no longer standing outside, but we boldly come into His presence. The blood of Jesus helps me to do the will of God. The blood of Jesus causes us to overcome Satan. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And then the blood of Jesus gives us safety and protection. We pray the blood of Jesus over the doorpost of our life and the doorpost over our homes. And then the blood of Jesus speaks for us. It speaks of life. It says it speaks better things than that of Abel's. Abel's blood spoke of death. Jesus' blood speaks of life. There is life in the blood of Jesus. And I'm able to say, my Father. And then we pray that same direction, hallowed be Your name. We bless and praise the name of the Lord. He inhabits, He lives in, He dwells in the praise of His people. Let everything that hath breath, we are to praise the Lord. He is Jehovah, our righteousness. He is our sanctification, Jehovah sanctification, Jehovah my peace, Jehovah who is there. He's Jehovah who heals. He's Jehovah whose provision shall be seen. He's Jehovah my banner. He is Jehovah my shepherd. I hallow, I praise, I bless His name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. I bless Your holy name. I bless Your holy name. You forgive all of my iniquities and You heal all my diseases. Amen? Amen. Well, then we come from the direction of prayer to the destiny of prayer. And the destiny of prayer is where I spend the majority of my time in this whole prayer experience, because we are praying for His kingdom to come, and His will to be done. in verse number 10, Matthew 6, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Spend time in declaring the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God is His reign and His rule in the hearts and lives of the believer, in the hearts and lives of you and me. The kingdom of God is now. It's not someday. I'm thankful for heaven. I look forward to heaven. Man, we have no idea. I have not seen, ear hath not heard what God has for those who love Him. It's going to be amazing. But the kingdom is not heaven someday. The kingdom of God is now. It's in us. It is today. The kingdom has a king. He's in charge. He's God. He's Lord. And guess what? I'm not. It's His kingdom. Not my kingdom. Not the Island Church kingdom. Not your kingdom. But it's His kingdom. His kingdom to come. His will to be done. Let me share this with you about the kingdom, about the kingdom of God. Listen closely. The kingdom of God means this. Everything that God has ever done and everything God will ever do, He is ready to do now in us. It's His kingdom. What He's done, what He will do, and it's about today. It's in our hearts and lives today. And if you remember, we talked about praying the kingdom. I take time, I spend time. Your kingdom come. Jesus said this. He said, when Pilate said, you're the king of the Jews. Are you the king of the Jews? And he said, Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this earth. It's not of this earth. It's not natural. What do we know? We know that the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking. It's not natural, but of righteousness, peace, joy. We went through each of these in detail. And how I pray that, Lord, your kingdom, righteous. I'm right with God. Living holy, following in your footsteps, dying to self, righteousness, peace, peace with God, peace of God, peace with others, righteousness, peace, and then joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength, amen? But what about this? The joy of the Holy Spirit. Do you know that wine in the New Testament is symbolic of joy? And isn't it interesting that the first miracle that Jesus ever performed, He performed at a wedding, and He took something common in every day and added His touch, and He brought joy. Jesus is the one who adds joy. The Holy Spirit brings joy to our marriage, amen? It brings joy to our relationship. We're the bride of Christ. It brings joy to our relationship with our Father, amen? And so the joy that the Holy Spirit brings. So I pray this over my life. God, it's not about this world. It's not about what I can do. It's not my kingdom. This isn't my church. It's your church. Your kingdom come. I pray that for my life. Lord, my life belongs to you. I'm not my own. I've been bought with a price. And so, God, let your kingdom, righteousness, peace, and joy. And I pray it for myself. I pray it for Liz. Righteousness, peace, joy. I pray for her desires and dreams to come true. I bless her. I pray for my kids. I pray for Luke and Michelle. I pray the kingdom of God. I pray for Matt and Paige. I pray the kingdom of God over my kids, over my grandkids, over Freddie and Ida and Bessie. I pray it over Sam and Ida, or Sam and Liv. I pray the kingdom of God. And I take time. I fight for my grandkids. I fight for my children. I fight for my wife and my family. I'm standing in the gap on their behalf. I'm believing God for revival in my home. Amen. I pray for my life, my family. I pray for this church, the kingdom of God, righteousness, peace, and joy. I pray for our elders, our leadership. I pray for my staff. I pray for you. I pray that you live faithful, faithful to God. I pray for a harvest of souls. I pray, God, bring people from the north, the south, the east, and the west. And I pray that every Sunday people will come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. I pray over this nation. And in praying over this nation, I'm praying over this community and these communities. And I'm praying for our state, our county, our state, our nation. I'm praying over this world. It's where I take time to pray for missions and praying for a harvest, people coming to know Jesus Christ. You can list all so many things that you're praying. What better thing than for people to live in righteousness, peace, and joy? Amen? That is not a picture of this world. It's not of this world. That's the kingdom. That is the kingdom of God. And so I pray his kingdom. And then the next step is this: your kingdom come, and then your will be done. Your kingdom come, and your will be done. That is the destiny of prayer, the kingdom and the will of God. The ultimate purpose of prayer is to see the kingdom of God come in earth as it is in heaven, and to see the will of God take place in earth as it is in heaven. This is where there's a lot of misunderstanding concerning prayer. And I pray this morning, prayed, and I ask God right now to give me the ability to communicate this point with clarity. Because I think we misunderstand it. We see it in a cultural lens of 21st century Western culture living. And somehow we think that when we come to your will be done in earth as it is in heaven, that we are arm wrestling with God. And we're trying to twist God's arm into doing something that he don't want to do, but we want him to do. We do our best to manipulate. Now think about this. We're trying to manipulate God into doing what we want. You see, prayer involves two wills. It involves the will of God, and it involves your will. And how many times have you walked into the presence of God, talked to God in prayer, when we've already decided what we want and how we want it done? And we want our will done. And the real destiny of prayer is not my will, but it's your will, Lord. Prayer is not overcoming the reluctance of God. Prayer is finding what God wants, and it's saying, God, I want in on this. Your kingdom, your will. I want to know what your will is, because I want in on what you are doing. And see, God's will is what's best for you. And you don't see that right now. And I don't see that right now. There's times things happen, and I just don't see it as that's what's best. But too many times we're like a spoiled child, or maybe we got a rebellious streak in us, and, you know, a teenager that wants to do something, they're going to do this or die and go here or go there. And, man, are they ever working it, mom against dad, dad against mom, trying to every angle you can think of. Not saying my kids did that all the time. But, boy, we do that. And we're wanting what we want. And it's like a selfish, it's like a brat of a child, how they would act. I've got this all figured out. How many times have I gone before God and I've got it all figured out? I know exactly what he ought to do. And I let him know, God, I really believe this is what you ought to do. And here is how you ought to do it. And here, and now I want to tell you when you need to do it. And I think he looks at me in just utter marvel and disgust. To pray, your will be done. It's your will. Your will. It's not my will. It's when my will, I come before him and I have my will, but when I come before him in prayer, I'm saying this, God, I want my will to come into conformity with your will to be done. And see, that's exactly what happened in the Garden of Gethsemane. And I believe that this is in the Bible to help us. I'm going to allude to this, but it's in Mark 14. It's in your notes, verses 32 through 42. You get down to verse number 36, and Jesus has taken his disciples, and he's asked them to be there with him to pray. He goes a little further, and he's in the garden. And he recognizes that his time has come. And I want you to hear his words. This is fascinating. He said, verse 36, he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Let me tell you how intense this moment was and how intense things get for us, but how intense, this is the ultimate. Abba, Father. It's where we get Daddy, Abba. I mean, he's going before the Father, and it's Abba. Oh, Dad. Oh, Father. If there is any way possible, remove this cup. He saw the cup, and he knew what it was. Now, why was this so intense? Well, there was the whole physical aspect of the cross, which no doubt made his flesh crawl. But you have to remember that he had never tasted sin. He had never been separated from the Father. And he's saying, everything's possible. Everything's possible with you, Dad. Everything's possible with you, Father. All things are possible. Remove this cup. But he didn't stay there because he understood. He understood it was about your will be done. And what did he say? Yet not what I will, but what you will. Yet not what I will, but what you will. Not my will, but your will be done. He knew that from the foundations of the world that a plan was set in place to redeem mankind. Knew that the fall would take place. Knew man would sin. God's all-knowing. He's omniscient. He knows everything. And from the foundations of the world, there was a plan set in place, and he knew that it would be his responsibility, that he would come to this earth, that he would put on flesh, and that he would die on the cross, and that he would take the sin of the world, that he would be separated from the Father, take the sin of the world, so that you and I could be saved. And so it wasn't about his convenience. It wasn't about his comfort or what he was going through. There was something greater. And what was that that was greater? It was your will. Your will. Not my will, but your will. So when we pray, what we want to do, here's what we want to do, is we want to find this out. What is the will of God? What is the will of God? His will is revealed in his word, and we want to figure out what his will is, God's will, and we want to bring our will in harmony with his will. We want to line up. This sounds a little bit harsh. You know I love you. All my heart. So let me say it this way. God's will is what you would want. It's what I would want. So God's will is what you would want if you and I had sense enough to know what we really needed. God's will is what you'd want if you had sense enough to know that that's what was best for you. It's really best for you. God is infinitely concerned with your life. He cares. He loves you. He knows all the heartache and pain and struggle and trial that we go through. But he knows what is best. So we come into his presence. And what God wants to do is he wants to work in us and show us in his word. He wants us to spend time. You see why prayer takes time? We're spending time. He said to his disciples, couldn't you tarry 1 hour? 1 hour seems like, oh, we could never do that. But when you start realizing, I got a lot of me in me. I got a lot of self. And he's trying to get that out of me and get me in line with his will. Because he has something he wants to accomplish in his kingdom. It's his kingdom and it's his will. And so I come into his presence. And what I'm to do is I'm to say, now, Lord, here's my will. But I want to follow in the steps of Jesus. And I want to lay my will down. I want you to change me, so that my will is in line with your will. It's like a combination lock. When I was in high school, we had lockers. I don't think they have lockers today. Everything's your backpack and everything's on a computer. But we had lockers, and we had locks on our locker, and had locks in our locker room. These caged lockers for our football, and coach gave us all combination locks. And you know, you turn it, turn a bunch of times right, and then you turn it and you get that number, and then you turn it all the way past and around one time, and then you hit the number, and then you just go back, just not all the way around, but just to that last number. And when you hit that number, what happens? All those tumblers inside that combination lock line up, and it opens up. That's what happens when my will gets in line with his will. It all gets lined up. And I'll tell you something, if you really want to get prayers answered, we always say, man, I wish God answered this prayer, I want him to answer my prayer. Well, let me tell you how to get prayers answered. Get your will in line with his will. and you'll see more prayers answered than you've ever seen in your life. Because that's the whole objective here. His kingdom, His will to be accomplished. My will in harmony with His will. Thy will be done. Now, we're praying for something. I'm praying that something will happen that has not yet happened here on earth. And we're praying God will bring about His heavenly purpose here on earth. Now hear me real good on this. I feel like the Lord gave this to me, man, and I'm writing it out. God has a will. God has a will, a purpose, a plan for every day. And I do believe that God has a will for my life. But I don't think this portion of Scripture, your kingdom come, your will be done, is all about my life. I think it's all about His kingdom. And so, you know, we just get consumed. Oh, Lord, what's Your will? What's Your will? Where should I go to school? Should I go to this school? Should I buy this car? Should I not buy that car? Should I move this? Should I buy that house? Not this. Oh, God, should I do this investment? Oh, help me, Lord. And we make it about these things. Oh, God, I need to know. And when we come to this portion of Scripture, and let me say this, it's not that God's not concerned for your needs. He loves you. He's provided for everything you will ever need in this life and for the life to come. And my God shall supply all your need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Amen. David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread. God provides for His children. All right? And we're going to talk about this in weeks to come because He gives us the opportunity to pray. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. And that's why I believe this is a daily prayer, because that's part of it. And God's always trying to get us to live in the now, live in today. How often did the manna rain down from heaven? Every day. Why didn't He just give them a whole bunch? Because He knew they wouldn't trust Him if they had it stockpiled. So He was helping them to understand their daily dependence upon Him. And so I believe He has a daily plan and purpose. And I believe that He's going to take care, give us this day our daily bread. He's going to take care of us. He took stripes on His back for our healing. He provides for us. We've declared who He is. His name reveals His character, and He takes care. God is a good Father who knows how. If an earthly father knows how to take care and bless His children, how much more does the earthly or the heavenly Father provide and give to us? Amen? Yeah. So here it is. It's not about me. It's not about me. And this the emphasis here, it's not about you. And the sooner we learn that in life, the more fulfilled we're going to live. You know, I've referred to this several times this week, but Rick Warren, I think it's the most or the high-selling book outside of the Bible in recent times. The Bible's always the bestseller year after year. But it's been a number of years ago now, but he wrote The Purpose-Driven Life. And the first line in The Purpose-Driven Life is, it's not about you. And when I realize your kingdom come, your will be done. Your kingdom, your will, it's not about me. Here it is. I think this has to do with him and his will. Now watch this. And if I'm willing, he lets me be a part of all of that. His kingdom and his will. If I'm willing. Churches that keep Jesus the focus and his word and accomplishing his kingdom and his will and the ultimate purpose of his kingdom and his will all centers around the gospel being proclaimed. Churches that do that, people that do that, they're filled with joy, they're fulfilled in life. But because people make it all about them, have you ever wondered why churches just they will fight and fuss and divide, split? You know, nowadays church will split and then we call it a church plant. That's a joke. You know, I pastored a church that it ran, started off about 250 people, but every time it'd get up to 350 in years past, it'd get up so big, then they'd have trouble. They'd get to arguing, they'd had financial trouble, and people'd leave. And then they'd go through a time, and it'd start growing again, they'd get to a certain place, there was a lid there, and then they'd have problems, people would leave. And it was in this cycle, and Liz and I went there, and Liz is highly intelligent, I was young and dumb, and I just believed God wanted to do revival in that place. And the first series of messages I ever preached, I preached on prayer. It was a shadow of what I'm talking about, because this is a lifetime of learning that I'm sharing with you. And we began to see change, and we started praying and praying, and people started having devotional life and praying. And we got up to 300, 350, and then we broke through to 400. And then we broke through to 450, and then 500, and then we broke through to 600, and 700, and 800, 900, broke through 1,000. Man, we broke that thing. Why? Because the church changed to become a Christ-centered. It's all about worshiping him, his word, and it's all about the gospel being preached, people being saved and taking the gospel to the world. And here's what happens when we talk and we make it not about his kingdom and his will, but when we make it about my kingdom, or when we talk, everything's about my will. What, God, my will. I'm praying my will. Here's what happens is people, when they make it about them, they end up in church getting hurt. Now, let me just pause and say this. We don't allow this to happen. We don't allow people to get bitter and angry and mouthy here at the church. Here's what we do is we mark them. We put a mark on their forehead. Now, you know that's not true, but here's what the Bible says. The Bible says, mark those that sow discord among the brothers. The Bible says how blessed it is to dwell together in unity. There, God commands a blessing. Amen? And so what do we do? This multi-denominational church, you hear me talk about it. We choose to rally. We got some different theological views in our lives here, but we rally around Jesus, the cross, the blood of Jesus, the gospel, the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of the word. We rally together. Amen? But here's what happens when people make it about them. Happens in cities, it happens in country churches all across America. You got a church here, and 2 miles down the road, you got another one that used to be a part of that one. Here's what happens. People get hurt, bitter, sulk, have a bad attitude. They're babies. They're selfish. And then they want to wrap it all up in super spiritual wrapping paper and put their bow on it. And they mouth weak little prayers, if you will, that amount to Jesus, help me. Help me. Help me. Help me. You know what they're doing to me. You know what they're doing to me. You know what they're doing to me. Instead of realizing that they're a part of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is righteous. It's right living. The kingdom of God is peace. I have peace with God. I have peace in my mind. I have peace with my brothers and sisters. Amen. The kingdom of God's about being full of joy. Ain't no joy in that place. There ain't no joy in that life. Ain't no joy in their heart and mind. No peace in their heart and mind. They don't have kingdom mentality. They don't have God, your will mentality. You know, the scripture says this, that the kingdom of God suffers violence and the violent take it by force. There comes a time in our life when we recognize it's not all about me. It's not all about, well, what am I going to buy? Should I buy another truck? Should I not buy another truck? Should I buy another house? Should I invest this or that? The kingdom of God is about his will, his plan, his purpose. It's about it being established in my heart and life. It's representative of Christ here on earth. Amen? And we begin to stand and declare. We begin to prioritize. We want God's priorities to be established in our life. But so many times, people let the tail wag the dog. It's the tyranny of the urgent. Meaning this, we let and allow anxiety, troubles, the busyness of life to crowd out what we ought to be doing, and that's praying and seeking first the kingdom of God and his will. I'll tell you, folks, it's not rocket science. I used to say, as the football player said, it's not rocket surgery. But then hanging around all these football coaches, coach, I figured out you got to be pretty smart to play football today, so I'll leave that out. It's not hard. It's not hard. It's dealing with self. It's dealing with self. Let me go through this, and this is not in your notes. I'm going to rapid fire some things, so I encourage you, if you have a pencil or a pen, or you have your smartphone or tablet, to get these things down. Here's what I want you to see. The will of God, God's not trying to hide it from you. He's not trying to hide it from you. When I was a little boy, I'd go spend the night, a lot of Saturday nights, with my grandma. And my grandma was a mess. My dad called her a cattywampus. And you can put your definition in there. She lived in a three-room little kind of shack house. She loved me. She knew that I loved chocolate-covered cherries. I'm just a little guy, man, but she always had chocolate-covered cherries. She knew, man, I eat on those. So when I was coming every week, she made sure to have chocolate-covered cherries. Now, she also had those orange slices, candy. I didn't like those. But I like the chocolate-covered cherries. When I went to her house, guess where the chocolate-covered cherries were? As soon as you walked in, they were on the table. She didn't put them in the cupboard. She didn't hide them. She put them out because she wanted me to find them because she knew I liked them. God is not trying to hide his will, his kingdom, and his will. He places it out front. The reason we miss it is because we get consumed with our will. We want what we want. And if we will come into his presence and we'll allow him to take our will and it begin to be transformed and conformed into his will, everything changes. And a combination lock opens and we see we see the kingdom and we see his will, his plan, and his purpose. And so God wants us to know and to do his will. The devil wants to keep you from the will of God. That's why he gets us to focus on us. And everything's about us. And we become filled with doubt and confusion and anxiousness. And we get distracted and we get fears. It's all the enemy trying to keep us from thy kingdom, and your will to be done. Now, how do we know? How do we know? So if you're writing down, you know, what is the will of God? Well, you can know it. He doesn't hide it. The devil wants to keep you from it. And then how do you know the will of God? Well, and maybe a better way to say it is not how do you know the will of God. I think this is better. Because it's more than me telling you. Here's what I'm wanting us to do. I'm wanting us to pray. I'm wanting this is when you pray in this matter. I'm wanting you to get before God and discover. You discover. See, I can tell you things. I'm going to give you a lot of things. But there's something about us discovering. And so we discover it. Now, how do we discover the will of God? By diligently seeking him and studying his word. And the more you know of him, the more you will know of his will. And how do you get to know about him? It's through his word. Now, here's another thought for you. Stay focused on his will and his kingdom. Read, meditate on it, grow in it. We started this series with this verse in John 15:7 that says, if you abide in me and my word abide in you. If you abide in me, you are in me. You love me. You worship me. If you abide in me, you want to please me. You're obeying me. You're following after me. And my word's abiding in you. The word is alive. It's active. You're not just reading it, but you're meditating on it. You're getting it down inside of you. And then you're careful to observe all that the law commands, all that the word of God commands. It's if you abide in him and his word abide in you. And see, this is a part of prayer. Then ask what you wish and it will be done. The key is getting his will in us. Not my will, not do this, God. It's about getting his will. If I'm abiding in him, his word abiding, then I'm getting the progression down right. Of course, do his will. Do his will. I'm gonna outline a number of things. There's probably 30 things I'm gonna give you here in a second. But you can know them, but if you don't do them, They're not doing any benefit. So it is about doing his will. Don't just be hearers of the word, but be doers. Now, why don't we live out his kingdom and his will? It's a trust issue. We think he doesn't understand how heavy our burden is, how difficult our life is. We think that we know better. And so we have a hard time saying, okay, if I spend so much of my prayer time and I'm praying for the kingdom in others, and I'm praying for the kingdom in me, I'm praying for his will. Your will in me, my will to line up, and I'm praying his will to be accomplished in the earth. Somehow I'm missing it because in Western mind, it's all about us. And I got to get my prayer answered, and I got to know what to do. When am I going to do this? God, what do you think about this? And what do you think about that? It's really a trust issue. And the Bible says in Proverbs 3:5-6, to trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all, everybody say, all your ways, acknowledge him. You, God, it's you. And he will make straight, or he will direct your paths. Trust. The issue, the real issue is trust. Whether we do or whether we don't. So trust. Now, there are two types of God's will. Broadly speaking, there's two types of God's will. Number one, there's God's general will. I wish I had a better word, because when I say God's general will, you don't, it doesn't carry the punch of how important that is. But there's God's general will, and then there's God's specific will. God's general will is his revealed will. And where is his will revealed? It's revealed in the Word of God. The revealed will of God. See, here's the problem. We don't focus on the revealed will. When we get to this juncture in prayer, everybody's concerned with the specific will. The general will is what's outlined for us in Scripture. The specific will about should I marry this person or not, should I take this job, that's where the vast majority of Christ followers spend all their time. God, what should I do? What should I do? Man, people, Pastor, I need to talk to you. I just need to talk to you. What should I do? Should I do this? We're spending all of our time on this, on this unrevealed, the unrevealed, the specific will. Is the unrevealed will to God, the things that Scripture doesn't outline for us. And what I want you to see, that is, if we will focus on the revealed will of God, then we'll have greater understanding in the unrevealed. If we focus on the general will, the revealed will, then we'll have direction in the unrevealed, the specific will of God. Because how can you hear from God about specific things, what you should do and what you should not, if you're not obeying the will of God that you already know? And that's what we do. Oh, I got to know this, got to know this. And we're not doing what we know to do already. Why would God even be obligated if we're not doing what's revealed, what's just the plain, open, simple thing that we should be following after? But if we do that, then we're hearing his voice. We're lining up my will, I'm crucifying the flesh and my affections and my desires, and I'm getting in line with what he wants to do. Amen? So, let me give you the key. Here's the key. Focus on the general will of God. Man, it's quiet up here. Whew, I'm telling you. That's good. I just gave you the key. Lord, you know I need your help today. I'm giving you the key to your life. The key to getting prayers answered. The key, focus on the revealed will of God. Focus on the Word of God. And he'll help you with all these other areas of the unrevealed, the specific. Amen? Amen. Well, let me show you some things we need to focus on. Because is God concerned with this? Yes. But he's not concerned with this if we're ignoring and the vast majority of this. This, we're concerned with my will. God, this is what I want. This, we're concerned with his will, his word, and what he wants his kingdom, how he wants his kingdom to be represented. Amen. Here it is. What is God's will for you? Well, God's will is that you would be a Christ follower. God's will is for you to be saved. He came to seek and save that which is lost. He didn't want anyone to perish, but he wants everyone to come into everlasting life. God's will is that you love him with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. God's will is that you will be a witness for him, that you will be his ambassador, the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God, we got heaven someday. The kingdom of God, we're his ambassadors to this world. So we are a witness for him. God's will is that we be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be not drunk with wine, which leads to dissipation, but be filled. A command, be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. God's will is that we seek to do his will. God's will is that our minds be renewed, not to be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. God's will is that you have a prayer life. God's will is that you spend time in his word. God's will is that you are filled with joy, that you rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. God's will is that you pray without ceasing. God's will is that you give thanks in everything. God's will is that you're a giver and that you're a generous giver and that you're a cheerful giver. God's will is that you be a forgiver. God's will is that you be merciful. God's will is that you be a peacemaker. God's will is that you be kind. God's will is that you be honest. God's will is that you are a builder of people and not a destroyer of people. I think of the word meekness. Meekness is not weakness. We talk about that. It's strength under control. It's the picture of a rider on a horse, a big, massive, strong horse, got bits on it. That horse could buck. That horse could run. It could, but it's strength. Those bits, strength under control. It's got strength, but it's under control. God help us to live. We're strong in the Lord. Amen. But it's under control. Amen. God's will is that you prosper. Beloved, I wish above all things some as prosper and be in health as your soul prospers. God's will is that we be people of praise and worship. God's will is that we're not anxious about anything. God's will is that we're not filled with worry. God's will is that we not be filled with fear. God's will is that we love our enemies, walk in love, that we stop hurting people. Stop hurting people and then justifying it and manipulating and make excuses to make others look bad because we're trying to get what we want. Don't be deceived. God's will is that you don't be a deceiver. God's will is that you put others first. God's will is that you cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. God's will is that you live by faith. God's will is that you be sanctified, that you live clean and holy, that you submit yourself to God, that you resist temptation. God's will is that you live a moral, sexually pure life, which means you don't live together before marriage. You don't have sexual relations before marriage. You don't have them outside of your marriage, adulterous relationship before, that you walk according to God's word when it comes to purity. That's God's will for your life. God's will is that you take dominion, that you live with a sense of victory. God's will is that you live with a sense of confidence that my God can do anything. Nothing is too difficult for you. God's will is that you make disciples. God's will is that you quit making excuses. God's will is that you keep the right company. I'm friends with everyone, but the company I keep is a little bit different. God's will is that you learn how to talk right. That you not God's will is that you not take his name in vain, and it's not that you use coarse conversation. That's God's will. How can sweet and bitter come out of the same well of water? How can cursing and praise and worship come out of the same? So it's God's will that we control our tongues. It's God's will that we be filled Once again, I come back to this because I think it's the key to it. Stay filled with the Holy Spirit. It's God's will that you put on the whole armor of God to stand against the wiles of the enemy. Amen. Hey, that's just a handful. Is that not amazing? Now, just think, if we concentrated on doing the revealed will of God, if that's the way, that's king, those are kingdom principles. Those are the things that should be in a kingdom life and in the kingdom of God. And if we concentrated on doing the revealed will of God, I promise you, when you get over here, you're not going to have a crisis of what's God's will. You'll know. You'll walk in it. People live in crisis. The reason they do is because they don't live in the revealed will of God. Liz, join me, would you please? Amen. Can you say amen to God's word?
I'm so glad you joined us today for Island Church Online. If you prayed with us to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or if you rededicated your life to the Lord today, text NEXT to 251-244-2030. If you'd like to have someone pray for you, text PRAY to the number that's on your screen. And if you would like to give to help with the ongoing ministry at the Island Church, text ISLANDGIVE to the number on your screen or visit our website, theislandchurch.tv. Thank you again for joining us for Island Church Online. We hope to see you real soon.